Good morning, church. God is good, amen? Would you just stand with me and worship our God and Creator? What an awesome God we serve. Hallelujah, Lord.
It's more than superhuman, it's all you do. Your love is moving mountains in my life. I'm seated in heavenly places. Jesus, I'm in you.
Worshiping you, Lord Jesus, and I pray that as we sing that we glorify you the rest of the day, Lord, everything that we say and everything that we do, that it would be according to you and your will, Lord Jesus. And we just thank you for your Holy Spirit, Lord, as it moves in this place. And Lord, we just ask that you would take hold of us, Father, that you would use us, Lord, and that you would overcome us in every way as we worship you today. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your
Angels and saints, we sing worthy.
angels and saints, we sing worthy. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled died for me. I see his wound, his hands, his feet. My Savior on the cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down. Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name. Blazing sun will pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Lord, our God, one more time to you, Lord.
Well, come on. That's why we came. Come on, we came here to do just that. So let's not hold back now. Come on. Let's give him all the praise and all the glory. Hallelujah to our God. Amen. Woo. Amen. Come on, that's why we came today. To give him praise. To honor and bless him. With all our heart and our mind and our soul. All of our life with every breath. You can't do it. Maybe you can't do it in Ralph's or maybe at your job. There's no reason to hold back here. Come on, this is where we come. This is where we come every Sunday to say thank you for Monday through Saturday. That you were faithful. That you stayed with me. That you didn't give up on me. That there were arms I could run into Monday through Saturday. If you're here and you had a week like that, give him a shout of praise today. Come on. Hallelujah. Woo! Amen. God is good. I said God is good. Woo! So thankful. He said I could boldly come into the throne of grace in my time of need. You might be in a time of need today where you have somebody that can sympathize and empathize with you. That's been through everything that you've ever been through or ever will go through. Not only has he been through it and felt what you felt, all the pain of maybe you've been disenfranchised, maybe people have left your life, maybe you've been shut out of life, maybe life has been unfair. But I'll tell you all the above. Yeah, maybe you're with all the above, but I'm telling you, Jesus went through that. He not only went through it, he took it all without sin. He knows just how you feel, and he's the one you want to run to. Amen. Now, you might have all your ducks in a row today. Maybe everything's perfect. But if you're like me, you're thankful that he has loving arms to run into. Amen. That he's beautiful. He's wonderful. Amen. Just lift a hand to heaven today. I just feel that there's people here. You're got broken hearts. You've been stung by the unfairness of life. You're misunderstood. You want to do better. You know there's some things wrong in your life, but people just keep accentuating what's wrong. They don't seem to recognize the great things about your life. You're trying to fix those things, but you're frustrated because it seems like the negativity is just so huge. And that nobody's really talking about those great things that you have in your life. I want you to know the Lord knows. There's a healer in the house today. There's healing for everything that's going on in your life. There's nothing he doesn't understand and hasn't been through. But I want you to know he knows how to have the victory. He has your victory today. He is your victory today. Thank you, Jesus, for being so awesome. We're here to give you all the glory and all the praise. No one deserves it but you. There's no one like you. There's no other man or woman or human being that's ever come along that can compare to you. There's no one like you. You have the name above every name in heaven and earth and under the earth, Lord God. You have that authority and power. You're the King of every king and the Lord of every Lord. You're ruling and reigning on high, Son of God, also the Son of Man. You've been through everything. You are in a human body. You know what it's like. And so we rest in you today. We bring every little situation and we cast our care over on you, for you said you care for us. You care for us. We're not supposed to care for us. You care for us. So we just thank you that we'll be anxious for nothing because we have somebody that loves us. Somebody who has answers, who is the answer. And so we confidently, expectantly are resting in you today, expecting a favorable outcome, a glorious outcome. Okay, yeah, I just sense that God's doing some things behind the scenes, that some things will be taken care of by when you get home and by Monday morning. I just feel like God's telling me that, listen, you've been honoring me in prayer, and you've come to me in prayer, and you've been bringing me this in prayer. I want to let you know, some things will be taken care of before Monday is over. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Now, if that's you, you have to come and testify. If that's you, you have to shout it from the mountaintop. You have to come and say, by Monday it was over. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Just right above, right below the shoulder blade, there's some pain in your back. There's shooting pain in your chest. You were thinking, man, it feels like I'm having a heart attack. No, it's stress. And God is saying, just give it over to me today. Just cast it over on me today. I can handle this thing you're going through. You don't have to worry about it. You don't know the end of it, but I do. And the end of it is that I love you and I'll never leave you or forsake you, and I'm going to take care of it and I'm going to turn it around for your good. So just trust me in that today. In the name of Jesus. How many need to just cast your care over on the Lord? You ought to lift your hands if you're casting your care over on the Lord. This means check out my hands, Lord. I don't have it anymore. I've given it over to you. They're empty of care and anxiety and stress. This is me telling you, this is all yours now. I'm not going to take it back. I'm not going to worry about it when I get home. I'm not going to talk about it to other people. I'm going to tell people that I've given it to you, and you're going to take care of it for me. So we just thank you for that, Lord, that we can come boldly to you. Just so loving, so good, so wonderful. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen. Can we give him one more praise today? Come on. Hey, what a God, what a friend. What a friend we have in the Lord. What a friend we have in the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. That's good. All right, hey, hug and high five those around you and just tell them I'm here for you. You don't have to worry about it. The Lord loves you and I'm here for you.
All right, good morning, In His Presence Church. How we doing? Woo! My name's Eric.
My name is Camille, and we want to take this moment to go ahead and welcome everyone for joining us for the very first time.
That's right, guys. If this is your very first service here at In His Presence Church, we're super excited to have you with us today. We have a gift we want to get in your hands. Show them, babe.
Yes, it's a lovely gift. It's an In His Presence Church mug. You can put your coffee and tea in there. It's just going to serve as a sweet reminder of your visit here at In His Presence Church. We also have an awesome message from Pastor Mel in there as well.
So if it's your very first time, all you have to do to get one of these gifts is go ahead and raise your hand right now and keep it raised and wait for one of our greeters to make their way over to you.
Woo! Welcome. All right, welcome. They're just bringing around a brochure that has some information about our ministry and things you might find interesting about In His Presence Church.
Yeah, now on the back, there's an attachment. Go ahead and fill this out right now. And at the end of the service, take it over to our lobby. You see our first-time guest table there, and there'll be someone there to exchange the attachment for the gift.
Yeah, absolutely. They're just going to welcome you, love on you, hug on you, and invite you here at another service here at In His Presence Church.
That's right. And let Camille and I be the first two to welcome you to come back. We love having you with us here this morning. We love to see you again next week. So, church, let's give them one more great big IHP welcome.
Woo, welcome, welcome.
Oh, and one more thing, guys. On June 24th, we have a special event for the youth. It's Friday.
Yes.
From 6 p.m. to 9 p.m. It's a party that we have. It's a special service for the youth. And there we're going to have pizza. What else?
Yeah, free pizza. There's going to be awesome music. And they're going to get to hear from our awesome leaders in there as well.
Yeah, it's just really important for the teens to establish really, you know, healthy, good relationships. Because, I mean, I was a teacher before. And out there, man, they're in the battle. You know, the devil's just trying to take them, lead them astray. So it's real important for them to develop these relationships. And they could do that here at this church. So, Awesome. Bring them. All right. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank y'all. When is that again? When's that going to happen?
June 24th.
June Friday. 24th. All right. Good. It's great. We love our young people here and the young adults and the youth. We love being able to be a blessing to them. You might know some kids around your neighborhood. Maybe you know some people that you've been trying to witness to, and they haven't been responsive, but yet they have children or youth. Go get them. Tell, I'd love to bring them to my church and bring them here. You can't imagine how many kids start their parents in this journey with the Lord. They get on fire, and their parents get on fire, and that's the way it goes. So don't ever underestimate bringing those young people. Amen. All right, are you ready to give today? Did you come ready? Amen. Amen. Hey, listen, let me tell you something. They're going to pass out the envelopes. Go ahead, guys. Y'all can do that now. I was reading about Cornelius, and it's just a great story. He's an unsaved gentleman, and God comes to him and says, Cornelius, your prayers and your giving has come up before me. Isn't it amazing how somebody who's not saved, doesn't know God, can stop God in his tracks? I mean, if you were to ask somebody, what are the two things that would get God's attention for my life? Most people would not say prayer and giving. But in Cornelius' situation, God said, this has come up as a memorial. This is right in my face every day. Your praying and your generosity is right there, and I can't get away from it. I'm going to tell Peter to come. He's going to preach the gospel to you, and you're going to be the first Gentile convert into the kingdom. What a blessing. What a reward for being somebody of prayer, believing God, and giving generously to people and to God's causes. So I encourage you to be a generous person. Make sure that there's generosity. If you're holding on to things because you're afraid of what tomorrow might bring or not bring to you, come on, you need to let that go and trust the Lord. Amen? Let faith arise, and let's go ahead and give and bless God's house. There's nothing like it. You can't get anything like the house of God anywhere. Nothing can match a place where his people come, his body is there, the head of the body, Jesus Christ, is there, and the power of the Holy Spirit in the presence of God. You can't match it. So let's make sure we tell God we love it, we're thankful for it, and here's our sacrifice, Lord. We want to make sure you know we're going to help in everything we can do. Amen? Are you ready to give today? Amen, amen. Okay, when you're ready, just hold your envelopes up. I'll wait till everybody has them up, but just hold it up as a memorial before God. You know what David said? He said, I am going to go into the house of God, and I'm going to pay my vow in the middle of the sanctuary. I'm going to let everybody know that I'm here to honor the Lord. Amen. That's what he said. So let's pray. Father, we just thank you right now in the name of Jesus that God, everything we put our hands to would be blessed. As we give today, as we bring this tenth, it says that all is yours, but that we know you've given us everything. But we bring this back to you in worship to you. And we thank you, Lord, that everything good in our life comes from you. As we plant this seed as an offering, you said it would go into the ground and come back a harvest. Some 30, some 60, some 100-fold. So we thank you for that, Lord. We're in full expectation and faith that it's returning to us. We give it because we love you, but we know that you use the seed to bless us. And so we're going to make sure that we honor you with everything that comes back into our life. You said you'd meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Every need. God, there's some people here today. Their businesses aren't flowing like it should. There's been a stoppage in the monies that are coming through. They need more clientele. They need greater staff. Father, they need buildings and they need locations. I'm asking you, Lord, to bless them. I'm asking you as we give today that it be given back unto us good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Some people need jobs. Some people need better jobs. They need jobs where they'll be celebrated and not just tolerated. They'll need jobs where their bosses would recognize the jewel that they are, the beauty that's alive in them, and they would bring out the best in them, God. I just thank you, Lord, that every bill is paid and every debt is canceled. I thank you, Lord, that you'll bring a freshness and a newness in the life of people and the progress that they're making, that they'll have monies to send their kids to school and for clothing and everything that they need. You said you'd meet every need, not according to their needs, but that you'd meet it according to your riches and glory, that it'd be according to what you have and not what we have. And so we thank you for it, and we receive it today. It's such an honor to be able to give and bless your house. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Come on, let's go ahead and give today. Amen. And while we're doing that, You know, we have a pastor here that's beautiful and wonderful and has been special in His Presence Church and in the house of God. She's been special to me and to everyone that I know that she comes in contact with. They love her. There are people all over the world that honor our pastor. And so it is her birthday month. Now, Desiree doesn't have a birthday day. She has a birthday month where you start it. I've learned this over 34 years. You start at the beginning and you keep it flowing, Mel, all the way for 30 days. You just keep it going, buddy. You keep it going. So we have people that had wanted to send in their honoring of Pastor Desiree, generals in the body of Christ. And so I would love it if we could just show that and you could help me honor Pastor Desiree Ayers on her birthday month this month. And so let's watch that now.
Hey, happy birthday, Desiree. You're a dear friend and you are much loved and appreciated. Cindy?
Happy birthday, Desiree. I just want to let you know how much I love you and appreciate you, that you've just been such a blessing to all women, to all your friends, and that you're just there and you're a loving, kind person that is just supportive of your family and friends. And we just love you so much for that. Happy birthday.
God bless. Happy birthday.
Desiree, happy birthday. Oh my gosh, we have known each other for 25 years maybe, like way before wrinkles and stuff. Oh, you look amazing. You are amazing. It is such an honor for me to be your friend. I've loved building God's kingdom with you here in the best city on earth. Happy, happy birthday, my friend. Love you.
Hey, Pastor Desiree. Hey, come on in here quick. You've got to say happy birthday to Pastor Desiree.
Desiree Ayers, I was shocked, girl, when they told me this is your 60th birthday. Come on. I tell you what, bless your heart. Happy, wonderful, and glorious birthday, Pastor Desiree Ayers. And I know all the folks there in His Presence Church, praise God, are just having a big and wonderful time about it. But Gloria and I just wanted to tell you how much we love you. And remind you what an important part you and Mel are to our lives. Be blessed, be strong, God loves you, and we love you, and Jesus is Lord.
Oh, I'm sorry, Pastor D. I was putting on my eye drops. Happy 60th birthday. We are so blessed to call you Pastor, but also our spiritual mama.
Happy birthday, Pastor Desiree, from your Mexican children.
Wait a minute. You're Salvadoran. I'm the Mexican.
I know, but when we went to Mexico, Pastor wanted me to visit my family from El Salvador, and I told her we're in Mexico. She said, yo, go visit them.
That's what we love about you, Pastor D. You're always humorous, you're hilarious, and we love that about you so much, and especially how you've always saw the best in us when we were at our worst, and the privilege that we have now to be able to pastor so many people and love on so many people because of your impact in our life.
Thank you, Pastor Desiree. I believe that I am a woman that I am now because you encourage me to pastor, you encourage me to preach, you encourage me that I'm able to lead. So thank you so much. I love you, and I wouldn't be the same woman that I am without you.
Happy, happy 60th birthday. We'll see you soon, Pastor. Bye-bye.
Happy birthday, Pastor.
Hi, Pastor Desi. We just wanted to say happy birthday. We know this is a very special birthday for you. You're going to be 60 years old, and you are an amazing pastor, an amazing woman of God. What a testimony you have. And I'm just with a couple of my grandkids. I think I have 12 altogether. So these are three of them, and we just have a birthday wish for you. So you kids ready? One, two, three. Happy birthday, Pastor Desiree. Love you. Hello, Desiree. This is your Texas mama. I wanted to say a big happy birthday to you and from our family and from the friends here at Lakewood Church. You're one of my favorite people, and when I was there, you treated me and my daughters like we were queens, so I will never forget all of that. And I love you and Mel, and I thank you for all that you're doing. I thank you for the good work that you're doing. You could have died, but for God. So thank God he let you live so you could have that church. You're a remarkable woman of God, and I love you, and I thank you for being a friend to me. We'll be friends forever, and I want to see you someday soon. Okay, I love you. Happy birthday.
Well, I can hardly imagine energy is happening right now as the celebration of Desiree's birthday is in motion. I don't know who the first person who dared to acknowledge, and I understand it's public information, that it's her 60th. To look at that woman, nobody would guess it, but what would you expect of a person who started out as a stunt item in the motion picture business? I'd say they're in good condition. She survived that. And she has not survived, but thrived in a marriage to Mel between the two of them has brought about the vitality and life and ongoing ministry of In His Presence Church. Our friendship goes deep and it goes long. And on this occasion of your celebration, Desiree, Anna and I send our greetings, both of us. It's a happy thing to think about. And I think with your health and well-being, and the strength probably is lungs as well as body by reason of your history in your vocation in motion pictures, that you probably can blow them all out with one breath. A thing that few people could do when they're as old as you are now. God bless you and happy birthday.
Hi, Desiree. I just want to wish you a happy birthday. For 60 years old, you are inspiring. You are the most wonderful friend I could ask for. I love you with all of my heart. You are full of wisdom. You are full of just joy. I love being around you every chance I get, and you are the sister that I never had. Thank you for being who you are. Happy birthday, girl.
Hey, I think we need to record this over because she messed up. It can't be her 60th. It's got to be her 50th. There's no way she's 60. I know Mel's old, but not her. Hey, listen, we just want to say happy birthday. Love you so much. Enjoy all of our times together. With you guys, we always have belly laughs. We're sitting around playing cards. It's always fun. I know you win a lot. You and I are the winners. Anyway, we always hear you do your cheer. My wife wanted to do that. I'm not going to do it. If she wants to do it, that's up to her. But we love you, and we just want to say happy birthday. Wish we could be there, and we look forward to more times together.
Hip hip hooray, hip hip hooray, hip hip hooray for Desiree.
Oh Lord, happy birthday.
Happy birthday, my chosen sister, my chosen friend. I love you so much.
Happy birthday, Desiree. I remember the first time that we met you, Des, we were there and we ministered at your church, and then that night we went out to the Jerry's Deli, one of our favorite places, and Mel and I were talking and we were just getting to know you, and I overheard you all talking about your testimony. I just couldn't believe it until you showed the little mark on your hand. And Desiree, you're a walking miracle. You're a miracle of God. You're a testimony to God. Your faithfulness, your belief, and your trust in Him. We're just so blessed that you're in our family. I'm thankful that you're in my wife's family and my wife's life and in our family, our children's life. But I'm so thankful that you and Trello formed such a wonderful relationship, Des. We love you. We bless you on this day. Happy birthday to you and Mel. You got a great one there.
Woo! Desiree here. Surprise, surprise, surprise. You didn't know that I could play that tune for you on your birthday. Happy birthday!
Happy birthday, Desi. You are a blessing to
just
us, and our entire church and family loves you.
Exactly.
Yeah, we all love you very much, and we celebrate your 60th birthday. The best is at hand for you, my dear friend, and more is to come. We're excited for all that God has
just
placed
you.
In you, and the more that He's going to be pouring through you.
Just for you.
Just for you.
Feliz cumpleaños.
Happy birthday, Desi. Love you.
Happy birthday, Pastor Desiree. We're so happy for this day in your life. And thank you for years of wonderful friendship. friendship. We love so much that you're always about winning souls for Jesus and reminding us that God is a miracle-working God.
We adore you, we respect you, and we follow you in ministry, and we are so grateful for your life. If you weren't born, all the souls that you have brought to the kingdom, would they have heard? All the people that you've reached out and you've prayed for, no matter what time of the day or night it is, you're willing to go and pray for hurting people. We just respect you with all our heart. Pastor Desiree, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Pastor Desiree, Victoria, and I want to wish you a very happy 60th birthday, tell you how much we love you. Every time we're around you, we're better. You're such a joy and an inspiration. I love your heart to help other people, and you and Pastor Mel are just great people, and we celebrate what God's done these last 60 years, but we pray your next 60 years will even be better. Happy birthday from all of us here at Lakewood.
Amen. Come on, would you stand to your feet and sing with me as we just bless our pastor? Happy birthday to you. Cha-cha-cha.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday, dear Desiree. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, baby.
I wanted you all at my birthday party, so we're just having it today. Thank you so much. You can have a seat. It's just an honor to be alive at my age. I so appreciated everything that these generals had to say and just people that I love in the body of Christ. And quite honestly, when I met Jesus at age 25 and started to attend Copeland meetings, I never dreamed in my wildest years that I'd be able to actually ski with and spend time with all of these amazing people and to pastor all of you. You're such an amazing church. You're the best church on the planet. And I thank God for you. So Father, I thank you right now in the name of Jesus. I thank you for this day. And Father, just as I was so honored and celebrated for this time and age, Father, I thank you that each and every one of us, we are born for such a time as this. And Father, I thank you that our ears are open to hear your voice, that our eyes are open to see what you want us to see. And Father, right now, I just declare the windows of heaven are open in this place. I declare the devourer is rebuked from your people's lives. And I declare that our favor is now. I thank you, Father, for supernatural healing for each and every person in this room. I thank you, Jesus, that you are the healer. You make a way where there is no way. And I thank you that you went to the cross so that we wouldn't have to live in pain. So I just thank you for healing pain right now, healing pain that's in the heart, healing pain that's in the mind, any type of mental torment, healing pain that's in the body. I thank you for good news going forth that nourishes your bones. And Father, I thank you for merry hearts that do good like a medicine. In the mighty name of Jesus. Today I'm going to share with you some ageless and timeless truths that I've learned throughout my life that I think work at any age. I know that at age 20 we worry about what people think of us. At age 40 we don't care what people think about us. At age 60 we finally recognize they're not thinking about us. Everybody's thinking about themselves. But the first ageless and timeless truth that I want to share with you that I believe will help you in your life is that you would know you are born on purpose with a purpose. God has a plan for your life, and it's marvelous. Jeremiah 29, verse 11 says, "For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. They are thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope." Now, I'm a valley girl. I grew up here in Woodland Hills, and I can remember at age 5 driving in the car on Ventura Boulevard right near Shoup. And on Ventura Boulevard, I saw a man in a wheelchair, and at age 5, it was the first time that I saw anyone in a wheelchair, and I just remembered my heart so went out to this man. I said, Mom, please, let's turn over. Can we help him? We need to help him. He needs to walk. You know, there was just something inside me that wanted this man to walk. And, you know, when I got into ministry, I can remember I started out going to Women's Aglow meetings, but all of a sudden people were getting healed. They were taking their walkers and throwing them away. I went out when we first started the church and ministered at a church in Las Vegas, and one of the elders was in a wheelchair that we prayed for, hadn't walked in years, got up and started walking. So I had a miracle. Many of you guys know that I was blown up in a fire explosion. Intensive care, critical condition at the Sherman Oaks Burn Center, fighting for my life, had my face, neck, arms burned, and second, third degree burns, and my upper lip taken off. And I thank God that I'd had 2 years of going to Copeland conventions, sitting under the Word of God, that I had heard the truth of the Word of God, that His Word is health and healing to all of our flesh. I thank God for the teaching that I had, that I didn't just give in to the fact that the nurses said I was going to be scarred for the rest of my life. You know, you don't have to listen to what people say. There is a higher truth. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And the truth is Jesus Christ, and He is healer. And His Word alone, He is the Word. You can stand on that Word. You can believe that Word, and it will change the natural situation that you're in. Life and death is in the power of your tongue, so I encourage you to speak words of life. But you know, this is at a young age, but I believe this was put in me for a reason. Now, Mel, I can look at pictures of him when he's 5 years old and younger, and he has his little guitar, and he's singing in different videos, and he was writing songs at a young age, imitating Elvis Presley, and you know, as we just grow in God, He takes every gift and He uses it for His glory. Now, I have never in all my years, and I've been around a lot of ministries and I've been all over the world, I have never heard a psalmist anointing that carries the anointing like our Pastor Mel when he's flowing in that gift. It's such a beautiful gift. This was in him at 5 years. This was in me at 5 years. There's something that's been put in you since you were a little child that God knew, that He formed you, He made you. He knows the plan and purpose for your life. It's in you. There's a script for your life. There's a purpose. And sometimes I think we can get tripped up and like get worried about what our purpose is, what our destiny is. And I'll tell you a scripture that's just helped me through my entire life. And it's Matthew 6:33. Seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else is going to work out fine. Everything else is going to be added unto you. Because sometimes the situation looks too big, or you can't figure it out, but you can always go, no, I can seek God. I can get up in the morning. I can read the Word. I can pray. I can do what I know to do and trust God to do that which I don't know how to do. He is more than able. So you're never too old to set another goal and dream a new dream. And as you're going through life, and again, I believe there's a script that's for each one of us. Every one of you has chapters in your book, and we don't want to get stuck in a chapter. Sometimes it's time to move on to the next chapter. But in this script of my life, when I met my husband in an acting class, and I looked at him, I went, oh, he's supposed to be in my script. He has a starring role as co-starring. I need him in the script, you know. Of course, he wasn't, you know, he was in his own book. And I was not on a page in his book, in his mind, but praise God, he turned the chapter and came into, our books collided. But, you know, sometimes you just know certain things. You don't know everything. But sometimes you just know. When I heard the Copelands, I knew that my destiny was locked to theirs. You know certain things, and you got to run with that which you know that God's put in your heart that is of him. Praise God. Hallelujah. Number two. God loves you, and he'll never leave you, and he'll never forsake you. This is a timeless and an ageless truth that I don't want you ever to forget. And I want you to remember that when you're going through a difficult time, because it's not a matter of if you'll go through a difficult time, it's a matter of when. The Bible says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God says, I deliver you out of every single one. So you have to remember that but part. And sometimes when we're in a trial, we're in the fire, we're just, you know, it could be so overwhelming that you want to quit. Well, the devil wants you to quit. Don't quit. Endure tough times. Toughen up. You're born, life can be hard, but you're born again for hard. You can do that. So I want to read 1 Peter 4, 12 and 13 from the Message Bible. So if you have that, you can go ahead and turn to it. And I'm just going to read it. It says, friends, when life gets really difficult, don't jump to the conclusion that God isn't on the job. And I want to stop at this line because I think this happens to people. They get to where something bad happens and it's like, why God? Like God's not there. Why'd you let this happen? Why'd you allow it? And I think people are clueless sometimes to what the Bible says. And we have to go to what the Bible says. You must understand, you saw those kids. I mean, we were visiting them in Thailand with Michael and Carol Hart. They have 200 little ones that they're raising up, and they're taken out of sex trafficking. They've been raped 15 to 20 times a day. These are the Bible kid students that came out of that, that have grown up. And you can see the joy on the face. You can see that Jesus has healed them. Now, you cannot tell me that God allows things, that God had anything to do with these kids being raped. He had nothing to do with it. Satan is the god of this world. That's what the Bible says. And the Bible says in John 10:10 that he comes to rob, to kill, to steal, and destroy. But then it goes on to say, but Jesus says, but I have come that you can have life and you can have it more abundantly. And he went and he got the keys from hell, and he's given, taken that authority. He defeated Satan and he's given them to you and I. So it's, what are you and I doing? Michael and Carol went in there and they rescued these kids. They did something about it. They took these kids back from the devil's territory. And just so you know, every time you give, we have supported them since they've started this ministry. When we didn't have money to give, we kept on giving to this ministry. Why? Because they built all these houses. They have missionaries from all over the world, and these kids are being fed, and they're being clothed, and they're being taught the word of God, and they're being raised. Well, that's their call. They're missionaries. But our call, you and I, we live in Los Angeles. This is our territory. And so we're called to be bright lights in a dark place, and we're called to do the same thing. We're called to take people out of the clutches of the enemy and bring them into the kingdom of light. So I didn't get past this one sentence. So when friends, when life gets difficult, don't jump to conclusion that God isn't on the job. Instead, be glad. This is a hard one. Can you imagine, be glad that you're in the very thick of what Christ experienced? He went through hell. He went to hell. He was crucified. He was betrayed. those nails in his hands and his feet, and he was perfect and pure in every way. He went through such a tormenting time before his crucifixion, knowing what it was. He was sweating drops of blood. That's mental torment. So he's reminding, God's reminding and saying, be glad you're in the very thick of what Christ experienced. And I think sometimes, because we can get victory, we forget. You don't get the victory unless there's a battle. And you don't make it through life on planet Earth without some difficulties. But you can, in the midst of it, do what the Word says and be glad that you're in the thick of it. And then it goes on to say, this is a spiritual refining process with glory just around the corner. And this is what I want you to underline. This is what I want you to highlight, is that glory is just around the corner. You may be going through a difficult time. You may be going through a situation, but in that you can press into God. You can relate to Christ's sufferings. You can cry out to him, knowing that after 3 days he was raised from the dead. And not only, I mean, people, this is huge. This is enormous. This is gigantic what Jesus did for you and I, that we could have life and not be separated from our Father. When we take our last breath here on earth, we're going to be in heaven forever and ever worshiping God. This is exciting news. But, you know, the reality is we're in these earth suits. We're here in a body, and it can be painful. But just know there is hope. Don't give up. Don't quit. God is a master of turning around a disaster. He can take your mess and make a message out of it. He can take that test and make a testimony. I know some people, they're like, you know, life just isn't fair. Well, expecting the world to treat you fairly because you're a good person is like expecting the bull not to attack you because you're a vegetarian. That's just doesn't make any sense, you know. Life on planet Earth is tough. Toughen up. You can do this. When you're going through hell, don't stop. Keep on going. You can handle it. Be strong and of good courage. You don't have to have a meltdown. You don't have to freak out. You don't have to be depressed. You don't have to take anxiety pills. You don't have to do that. You got Jesus Christ. He's your answer to everything. He's your healer. He's your deliverer. He's your way maker. He's your peace giver. Joshua 1:9 says, have I not commanded you? This isn't a suggestion, it's a command. Be strong and of good courage. Don't be afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Don't be afraid is mentioned 365 times in the Bible. Fear is a polar opposite of faith. And on many situations, we're either in faith or we're in fear. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When I was in the burn unit, the nurse came up to me and said, Desiree, you're going to be scarred for the rest of your life. I wouldn't look in a mirror, and she said, you're in denial. You need to start looking. I didn't have to look. I said, no, I'm not going to look. You know, you can say no. You can say no to the devil. You can say, no, devil, I'm not going to think about that. No, devil, I'm not going to be mad. No, I'm going to be forgiving. This is what I'm going to do. I said, no. My husband brought in these photographs of these 8x10s. This is what I'm looking at. This is what I'm going to see. I'm going to see what I'm believing God for. I was believing God not to be scarred. I was believing God to be healed. I walked out of that burn unit 10 days later, totally healed. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. I was listening to the word over and over and over, building up my faith for a miracle. The doctor said, Desiree, it's your faith in God that's healed you. He went on 700 Club. What the enemy meant to break me is what God used to make me. God put me on a platform, put me on TBN, put me in all these places to preach the gospel all over the world. I got an invitation to be on the Phil Donahue show. Who could imagine that? I was with Geraldo and all these TV shows, but I found out they kept editing. Every time I said Jesus, they just edit it. So I thought, well, you know, no point for me to do these shows. You know, I'm all about Jesus. I'm a Jesus girl now. All I'm going to do is read the word and pray and go into hospitals. And I saw miracle after miracle after miracle. And even Camille was just talking Tuesday night at my cell group, mentioning how she came up here with a tumor on her back and how when we prayed for it, it just dissolved. I cannot tell you how many tumors we just lay hands on them. They dissolve right then and there, just disappear. God's a good God. He's a miracle-working God. This is what God does when we believe his word, when we operate in faith and not fear. Fear would have liked me to just wither up and die. Don't fight. Give up. It's too hard. Stay home. You're disfigured now. No. You got to say no, devil. No. You know, the area he's such a fool. The area he attacks you with, that's a good indication where your strength is going to be. Why is he hitting you in that area? You see, because Jesus takes our weaknesses and he makes them strengths. You saw that clip from Holly Wagner. I remember the first time I went to the Oasis Church, and we're sitting in like the back, you know, middle row. There were only like, I don't know, 30, 50 people at the time. And Philip comes up to me and says, Desiree, Mel, would one of you like to take the offering? I thought I was going to pass out and have a heart attack. I thought, he would. You know, and then I went home and I just thought, oh, I don't even know if I want to go back to this church. You know, I can't believe he asked me to do this. This is just horrible. And then God spoke to me. Susan knows, she remembers those days, but God spoke to me and said, it was to share your testimony, because here I've been healed and had this miracle. And I said, well, you know, I'm talking with God. Well, yeah, God, I'll do that. And he said, good, because you're going to be doing it. And then Philip called like a couple days later, Pastor Philip, and said, Desiree, I heard you got a testimony and da-da-da-da. I want you to share it this Sunday. And so he handed me the mic, and that was it. You know, that was it. And I was a kid that faked having a bellyache so I didn't have to give an oral report. You see, God just does stuff. He just turns things around. He transforms you. He perfects everything that concerns you. So I'm just saying, in 3.5 years, Jesus changed the world with 12 disciples. Be open for what God wants to do with you these next 3.5 years. I just believe some of you won't even recognize yourselves. You'll be doing things that you never dreamed of, but yet you're going to be there and go, God, this is what I always dreamed of. This is what I'm born to do. This is my purpose. You know, you get Danon up here with a mic and you just go, oh my gosh, he's born for this. He's born to preach. It's so obvious. It's just different things. You step into your destiny as you're putting God first. 2 Timothy 2:3 says, therefore, you must endure hardships as a good soldier. You're in a war. You're a soldier. Now, I want you to get a hold of that, because if you're recognize that you're a soldier and you're fighting a spiritual war and you have a spiritual armor. And I taught on that about a month ago, the whole armor of God. But there's an armor that you carry in the spirit realm. If you're carrying all this and you're having all of this, could you imagine soldiers out at battle and they're fighting and they're in the thick and they see, you know, the enemy coming closer? Can you imagine a warrior going, oh, I'm so afraid. I'm so afraid. And they take their armor, they put it down, the guy's got a machine gun, he puts it down, oh, I just gotta have a meltdown. No, you can't have a meltdown. You gotta pick up that machine gun, you gotta aim it, devil, I'm taking you out. You know, no weapon formed against my family's gonna prosper. I'm gonna live healed, I'm gonna live prosperous. I'm gonna win my family to Christ, I'm gonna win my co-workers to Christ. In fact, I'm gonna win this whole city to Christ. Why? I serve a God of all things are possible. I'm just saying. Number three, I got to move on here. My time's running out. But this is important. Guard your heart. Keep it full of love. And I think many times when we think of guarding our heart, we've been hurt, people have betrayed us, and we get, oh, I'm not trusting anybody, I'm going to guard my heart. Man, I got a metal fortress around my heart, and I'm not letting anybody in. That's not what it means. Guard your heart means you're a love vessel. You're made in the image and likeness of God, and you're born to love, and your heart needs to love. Now, I get, we all go through the Judas kiss. There's not anyone that gets to go through life without that one. That's going to happen. But is that going to make you a Judas? Is that going to make you a nobody? Is that going to make you one of these people that doesn't trust anybody, not going to let anybody close, going to protect myself? Man, you're going to be lonely. You're going to get bitter. You're going to die early. You won't fulfill your call. It's all about the heart. You get born again by asking Jesus Christ to be Lord of your heart. It's the issues of the heart, whatever you're thinking about in your heart, the meditations of your mind, what you're thinking about, all that's in your heart. And the Bible says, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. And you can't let it get hard where you don't love people. You know, people are always going to let you down. They were never meant to be your all in all. God was. So you can have somebody and go, okay, you know, they're filling X amount of needs for me, like maybe 70 to 80%. You know, my husband's at 80%. But he was never supposed to be 100%. Jesus is. And if I try to get from him what I'm supposed to get from Jesus, I'm going to be very disappointed in my marriage. And so some people aren't getting, okay, well, you can't fulfill my needs. Let me go marry this guy. Well, there's going to be another 20, 30, could be 40% that's missing that you're still not going to get. Because that guy was never supposed to fill you. Jesus is. But when Jesus fills you, you can be happy with the 80%, that's going to be more feeling like 100% because you don't need anything from this person. You want to love and give to this person, which is what you're meant to do. You're meant to give. Everything about your heart, about life, about Jesus is give, 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 give. He so loved the world, he gave his entire life. Okay, praise the Lord. I just want you to forgive and live. Your life is too valuable, your calling too great, and your God too awesome to waste your life on what doesn't matter. Some people in your past don't matter for your future and your destiny. Find friends who align with your destiny and lose friends who alienate you from destiny. Do you want me to say that one more time? Find friends who align with your destiny and lose friends who alienate you from your destiny. Allow God to continually soften your heart so that it beats for what his heart beats for, and that's people. God cares about people. It's always about people. Love God, love people. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. You got to love yourself. You got to take care of yourself. You got to have a day of rest. I'm just going into complete mama mode right now. But take care of yourself. If you're so busy and so frazzled that you're depleting your health, your sanity, your peace, how are you going to be good to anybody else? Your family, your wife, your husband, your kids. You need time for yourself. You need your God time every morning. You need that. Take care of yourself. Number four, I kind of already hit part of this, but a relationship with Jesus is the answer to everything. And it's a relationship. To not have a relationship, you know, it'd be like me going, getting married to Mel, and then going by and then living my own life. And sometimes I feel like that's what people do. They come to the altar, they meet Jesus, and they're out the door, and they have no relationship with Jesus. And, you know, I have kind of a concern about that, because a relationship, at least the relationship I have with my husband, I don't go take a vacation without asking him. You know, I mean, of course I want to do all my vacations with him, but he doesn't like to ski anymore, and I still like to ski, and so he likes me to go with my girlfriends or go skiing with the Copelands. He'll encourage me to do other things, and, you know, of course, I check with him first. I don't just say, okay, he's not interested, I'm out of here, and he doesn't know where I've gone for 7 days. That doesn't work in a marriage. You know, if you want to have a happy marriage, you don't do that kind of stuff. You don't just go out with the girls or go out with the guys and your mate doesn't know. Mel knows where I am all day long. I love the app that Keith and Kyla got. They got some app where they can see. They just look at their phones. Oh, he's at home. He's there. And the other day, Mel was like, I don't know, a couple hours went by. Well, I didn't know where you were. Why don't you get that app Kyla has? You know? But, you know, we pretty much know. We're in relationship. How could you not ask Jesus about getting a job? How could you not ask him about the person you want to go out with? Or how could you not talk to him? It's a relationship. And I have a great concern for people who grow up in the church, especially. They think they're a Christian because their parents are Christian. No, you have to have your own personal relationship. It's not whether you can raise your hands. It's not, you know, it's not how many churches you attended, what Bible school you went to. Is, do you know him? Do you have a relationship? Do you guys talk? I know Mel. You got to know Jesus. I love what Dwight Moody said. And these are some famous evangelists that I'm going to quote right now. He says, the scriptures are given not to increase our knowledge, but to change our lives. So it's not a head knowledge. This is life. We are living it. We are doing it. And you were never meant to do life alone. You were meant to do it with Jesus. Christ is either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. Listen to what Charles Spurgeon said, and he's a famous evangelist in the late 1800s. But he said, have you no wish for others to be saved? Then you are not saved yourself. I'm going to let you just think about that one. I'll go on to what John R. Rice said, another famous minister who's now in heaven. He said, it's a sad and shocking fact that many religious people are in hell. See, it's not a head knowledge. It's not a Bible school. It's a relationship. And when you have a relationship with him, you know, he's a great encourager. You know, I hope you've been encouraged today, but he also convicts. There's a conviction, which you're not going to go do some of the things you used to do because you know it wouldn't please him. And you want to. When you know him and you have a relationship with him, you love him. And I think about people that are backslide, and again, this is a hard concept for me to grasp as a young Christian. When I met a gal and a stunt gal friend, she was telling me about backsliding. I'm like, why would anyone backslide? You know, I grew up in every cult imaginable, and when I met Jesus, he healed me and set me free of eating disorders, you know, all kinds of stuff. He set me free. He loved me. He gave me an awesome husband. I mean, my gosh, life is good now. Why would I leave this person? She said, well, I stopped reading the Word. I stopped praying. I stopped going to church. I thought, okay, you stop reading the Word, you got no wisdom coming in, no relationship with Christ, you stop praying, you're not talking to God, you're not, you know, having a fellowship with the Holy Spirit, and then you stop going to church, you cut off all accountability whatsoever. You're your own island. So, you know, I could see how that would happen, but I'm still at the place 34 years later. Why would you do that? You know, and throughout the years, in having various pastors, praise God, we got Pastor Jack. He's so solid. I love him. But, you know, we've had different pastors that have gone off the deep end and gotten into sexual immorality. And we've watched churches and tried to help churches. And some people survive and some don't. And this is what I found about the survivors. They're the ones that knew Jesus. But the people whose Christianity was just based on the pastor, when the pastor fell, they went out the deep end. I'm like, come on, people. You know, this is real. You got to know Jesus. And if your pastor messes up, surely in a city this large, you can find some pastor that's holy and pure and doing it right. There's still no reason not to go to church. Because the Bible says, don't forsake the assembly of yourselves together. You can't get around Scripture. I don't want people staying stuck in chapters of books, you know? When a chapter's closed, you gotta open the next chapter. God's always doing a new thing. His mercies are new every morning. You always want to keep growing and changing and letting God do his work inside of your heart and your mind. Pray daily. Pray this daily. God, create in me a clean heart. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. Don't let me stay the same. Change is good. Number five, to live a life of victory, you need the Holy Spirit. We're going to go really fast on these last couple points. But you got to have that. You know, I just think about the stresses of life. And I want to tell you, there is nothing that will de-stress you faster than singing in other tongues. When you're singing in the Spirit, you're talking to God, you're communing with God, and this amazing presence of God just fills you. That is so powerful. When you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you have the power to be a witness. Only 5-7% of Christians are actually leading other people to Christ. And I think, particularly myself, those 5-7% of people are people that are filled with the Holy Ghost, that are praying in other tongues, because they're building themselves up on their most holy faith, and they're being bold enough to get outside of their box and to share the love of Christ with others. But again, I have to go with Charles here and go, if you're not leading people to Christ, are you saved? Why would you let anybody burn in hell for eternity? You know, and we've been so great as far as a church. You know, we're just filling up again. You can see the church growing. We're great about getting souls saved, but we have a new thing we're doing, which is called making disciples. And that is not just letting them get saved and go live crazy like the world, but actually seeing them grow to become a leader. You know, like some of us, we're just so hungry, but some of us had friends, we had a husband, we had a wife pulling us in that direction. And that's what we got to do for other people. We got to pull them into the things of God, because the enemy's strategic and he's trying to pull them into the world. Look what you can do out here. Let's go clubbing. Let's go, you know, drinking. Let's just get our brain so fried we don't know what we're doing. Where God's saying, no, you get your mind stayed on me. I have perfect peace. And I have a plan for your life that is exceedingly, abundantly above all you could imagine, think, or hope for. And I'm telling you, just a couple little keys, putting God first, trusting him. I mean, whoever thought I'd ever get a chance to talk to Ken and Gloria Copeland? You know, at these minister conferences, it's packed with ministers trying to get their attention. But yet God will single you out for the people that you are destined to be in their lives. God has destiny people for you. And you're going to meet them in the local church. Every great person I've ever met in my life has been because we're connected with the local church. Local churches connected together. And we have a purpose and our hearts are aligned. We want to see as many people into the kingdom of God during our lifetime as possible. And then we want to raise up a next generation to carry the torch. I want there to be a army full of generals raised up here at In His Presence Church that know how that have a love for the Word of God, that know how to usher in the presence of God, because there are too many dead churches these days where you can walk in and the letter of the Word's being spoken, but there's no move of the Spirit. And then you have other churches where there's move of the Spirit, but there's no order, so it's so fruit loopy. But there's a mantle, I believe, that's been placed on myself, that's been placed on many, that it's time to impart to the next generation. It's time to raise up an army full of people that know how to get victory when battles hit. And you're going to need the Holy Ghost to do that. My last point, I have 1 minute left to share. But victory does belong to the strong. Victory does not belong to the strong. It belongs to the faithful. Don't quit. I took that off of Facebook from Pastor Mill yesterday. I like that line. Number six, is the best is yet to come. I want you to say that with me. The best is yet to come. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that Jesus is coming. I believe that we get to spend eternity in heaven. I just believe that we're in the greatest move of God. It's hellish out there. I mean, crazy stuff is happening. The enemy, of course, is cut loose in his camp doing all his terrorist activities and just garbage that's happening. We just pray for Orlando and every place else right now. We pray for our city, just healing for the people that are going through difficult times. But on the kingdom of God side, the miracles are increasing. The salvations are increasing. It's a great work. And it's an awesome time for you and I to be alive. I want to go ahead and pray. You can close your eyes and bow your heads if I can get a keyboardist just to flow with me as I'm praying here. Father, I thank you, Lord. I thank you for this time together. And Father, I thank you that this wouldn't just be a message, but Father, that people would hear your heart, that they would know that they have a purpose, that they would know you're not going to leave them or forsake them, that they would know you, Father, that they would be filled with the Holy Spirit. Father, I thank you, Lord, for soft and loving hearts, forgiving hearts. If you're here and that just spoke to you, you just need to deal with your heart and get it filled with love and forgiveness, just raise your hand. I want to pray for you right now. Father, you just see all the hands all over the building. I thank you for just touching their hearts. Father, I thank you for softening their hearts. I thank you for helping them. I thank you that they're just willing to forgive, Father. Their hand raised to you saying, God, I'm willing, help me. So, Father, I thank you for healing the hearts that have been hurt and wounded and filling them right now with your love and just the ability to walk in forgiveness, to bless, to pray, to do good, to turn away from evil and do good. I thank you for that, Lord. If you're here and it ministered to you as far as the stress, anxiety, worry, fear, if that's you, I just want to pray for you before we close. Just raise your hand right now. Father, I thank you for your people. And Jesus, I thank you that you're our Prince of Peace. And I just speak peace. In the name of Jesus, we command that storm to go. And Father, I thank you, Lord, that glory is just around the corner. I thank you, Father. I thank you that it's seared in their hearts that you're for them and not against them. So, Father, I thank you for blessing them right now. I declare you've not given them a spirit of fear, but one of power, one of love, and one of a sound mind. I thank you, Father, as a church, we're strong, we're whole, we're healed, we're anxiety-free, we're fearless, Father. You're raising up an army here, Father, and we're going to battle. And we're not moved by the wiles and the attacks of the devil, but we're moved by your voice, Father. And we thank you for times of rest. We thank you, Father, that we honor the Sabbath, that we keep it holy. And Father, I thank you for that rest in minds right now. People whose minds wake up on go. I just believe God's doing a new thing with your life. You know, you can train your brain to rule and reign. You can tell it what to think. You can reprogram it. You don't have to wake up anxious. You don't have to wake up worried. You don't have to wake up angst. You can wake up with the peace and joy of God every morning. If you're here and you don't know Jesus, you don't know that Prince of Peace, you know about him, but you don't have a relationship where you're consulting him on a regular basis, and you want that relationship, you want to walk with him, you want to experience his peace. If that's you, at the count of three, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, just raise it high where I can see it. I see that hand, I see that hand, I see that hand. Just raise it high, I see that hand. I see that hand, I see that hand. I see that hand, I see that hand. You can put your hands down. Before I pray for that, I want to pray for another area too. Because it's important that you have that relationship with Christ, but it's also important that you have the Holy Spirit, the power where Jesus said, I'm sending the Holy Spirit. They're three in one. It's the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. But I want to make sure you have the power of the Holy Ghost, which is going to give you the strength to break addictions, to witness to people, to operate in supernatural power gifts, and to have victory. So if you would like that gift, I want to pray for you at the count of three. One, two, three. Raise your hand where I can see it. I see that hand, 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 I see that hand. Hands going up all over. All of you that raise your hands to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to have Jesus be your Lord, or you're rededicating too. Some of you just need to rededicate. I want you to get your belongings and to come up front. I want to pray for all of you now. Just get out of your seats and come up front here so I can pray with you. All of you that raised your hands for Jesus being your Lord, in relationship with Him, and filled with the Holy Spirit, come on up. Come on up at this time. Come on forward. Thank you. Thank you. If you can do me a favor and just turn to your neighbor and say, I'll go with them so you don't have to go alone. I'll go with you. There's dozens of hands, and I don't want you to miss out on this blessing. You're fearless, remember. God's not given you a spirit of fear, but one of power, one of love, and one of a sound mind. So be bold and brave. Get out of your seat. If you raise your hand, get out of your seat and come on up here. It'll be good for you. You're going to meet a great God friend by coming up here. And the reason we clap, the Bible says all the angels in heaven rejoice when one person makes this type of decision. That's why we're clapping. We're rejoicing with all the angels in heaven. There's a few more of you I'd really like for you to come on up. Just be bold. Don't be nervous. Don't be nervous. Again, I want to tell you, God has not given you a spirit of fear. If you can stand in front of a group of people that love you, when all hell breaks loose out there in the world, you're going to be able to stand. So I know that you need to connect in. So I want you to come on up. Come on up. Okay, I'm going to come get you. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, let's pray. Let's all pray this together. If you're watching online, I want you to pray this with us right now. Let's pray. Say, Father God, I love you. Jesus, I believe that you came to earth. You died on a cross. You were raised from the dead. Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Lord, my Savior, my best friend. Forgive me for everything I've done wrong. I forgive everyone that's hurt me. I let it go. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and every gift that you have. I declare that the rest of my life is going to be the best of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to talk to this group right now for a moment. I'm so proud of you for having the courage and boldness to come up front. I want to make sure if you don't have a Bible, you have one. And I want to make sure you get everything that you came up here for. And so one of our prayer counselors, one of our disciples that Pastor and I have raised up in this ministry that we're working with, is going to reach out to you, and they're behind you to pray with you and for you. They'll invite you to come back to a Bible study cell group so you can meet other men, other women, because you need people. People are an important part of your journey, and you're going to meet the greatest people on the planet here at In His Presence Church. So if you turn around and meet them, they're going to welcome them out. Thank you, thank you. While they're heading out, we have a quick video to show you about our witness conference that's coming up. Also at 1 o'clock, we have youth every single Sunday, but take a look at this video.
About 18 months ago, I had a doctor tell me that I was going to lose my vision. And I went to 5 other doctors, and the diagnosis kept getting worse. I remember the day that the doctor gave me the diagnosis. This always really stands out to me. I remember saying that day that my life was over and that it would never be the same. And I believed that. But I started standing on the word of God, and my life has never been the same. Once I found Jesus, he changed everything. My life has never been the same. That was true when I said that. I went back to the doctors and found out that my eyes are totally healed. Jesus healed my eyes. He couldn't believe it. He kept going back and looking, and he kept checking, and it was as if I was speaking of something that never was there. He couldn't believe it. I'm so grateful that God chose me to have a testimony. I'm so glad that he trusted me to have a testimony, that he trusts me to go out and to be a witness. I want to share my testimony with everyone. I want everyone to know that Jesus is alive and that he can heal you. If you just trust him, he can do anything. He can do the impossible. He's the God of impossible. He has the final say in everything. God's word does not return void. If you just press into the word of God and you seek first the kingdom of God, everything will be added to you and your whole life will change. He changes everything.
Woo! That's our God, amen? Witness 2016. Listen, you know, God chose all of us to be a witness, not just Karen, all of us to be a witness. And Pastor Desiree touched on it a little bit. In Orlando last night, right now, there's 50 dead, 50 injured. 50 people last night went to a nightclub not knowing they wouldn't have it tomorrow. This shouldn't make us afraid. This should make us bold to go out there and be a witness, to make sure that we're sharing. When you go to a restaurant, that waiter, that waitress, they might not have tomorrow. So we need to be a witness, right? We need to go out there and make sure that we're bold. We're not afraid. We're bold for Jesus. So make sure you sign up, register. You can register out in the lobby. You can register online as well. So make sure you do that. Bring somebody that you're believing God for to this witness conference. Also, our School of Leaders will be back in here today at 1 o'clock with Pastor Mel. Our next God encounter is July 8th and 9th for men and women. If you did not go to the pre-encounter, no worries. We have a one day, actually just a couple hours. We're going to do it all at the same time on June 26th at 1 o'clock. You can come, men and women. So if you haven't been to the pre-encounter, to go to the encounter, just come. You don't even need to sign up. It'll be in room 8, but we'll give you more information next week. And next week, don't forget, it's Father's Day. So fathers, make sure you come. You're leading your home. You're letting your family and kids know that it's important to be in the house of God. Don't stay home just because it's Father's Day and you think you get a day off, right? We know how you can be. We know how it is, right? So just make sure you're leading your home and your kids and you're letting them know that God's first in your life. And I'm telling you, you're going to train them up right. We're going to have baptisms at the 9/11. Fathers are going to baptize our kids. We're going to have baby dedications at the 9 o'clock. So it's going to be a fun-filled day. We're going to have gifts for you, Dad. So make sure you come. Bring your children. Also, VBS, Vacation Bible School, they're trying to prepare. So make sure you're getting in your registration forms so they know how many. So go ahead and stand with me so I can pray you out. Remember, if you're not in a cell group, we have lists on our baptism table and the information center all over. We have cell groups Monday through Sunday, every day of the week. So men and women, there's always a day you can go. Just check it out. So Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father God, that we go out with boldness, Lord, to be a witness today, Father, that, Lord God, there would be no fear, that we would see each person, Lord God, that this might be their last day, Father, and that you're going to use us to witness Jesus to them. I pray blessings on each person here, Father. Bless their families, bless their marriages, their lives, Lord. I pray promotions for them. I thank you, Lord God, for each person that's here today, Lord God. It's not by accident. So go forward today, be blessed, be encouraged, and we'll see you Wednesday. Thank you.
I've begun to preach another key. prison soldier in you and tonight, searching and fighting to love's real life. A straight through our soul with invisible thread, the pieces undone.